Whether it's a hot time in Florida or a rainy night in Georgia,
living with trouble,
it's the perfect time for the TCB Cast, an unofficial Elvis fan podcast.
Oh, yes, sir. Good to see you. Go, sir. This bad fix spring is the hottest thing in the country. Real hot and blue. Coming to WHBQ in Memphis, Tennessee.
Welcome to TCBCast, an unofficial Elvis Presley fan podcast. I'm Justin Gosman.
And I'm Beck Wiles.
Beck, how are you doing this week?
I'm good this week. How are you, Justin?
I am doing really well. I just, for our patrons will know this, but just dropped into the Patreon feed another early access episode for the mini-series coming up in October, the Elvis and Country Music series. Garrett and I recorded the 60s portion of it, covering Elvis and the Nashville sound and all that. So I am pumped because it turned out really well, I think.
That's fantastic. Everyone's in for a treat in October, I have to say. So how many more have you got to record? Is it a five-parter?
Two, yes. It was originally going to be a four-parter. Now it's going to be a five-parter. We're going to try real hard to keep it at five. And we did kind of have to crunch on the 60s episode, because you're covering, you know, effectively 9-10 years of Elvis's career, which are the most busy parts of his career outside of the concert years. But we definitely had to brush over that, because we're also explaining, like, what the Nashville sound was and what was going on in country music during that whole period, and sort of comparing and contrasting what was going on in Elvis's music. So it's a lot of laying the groundwork of context. And yeah, I'm really pleased with how it's turning out. So hopefully everyone is excited. Get hyped, because it's coming. Mm. And hopefully all of our patrons are enjoying that as well. Speaking of our patrons, I have a couple, three new patrons, got to thank this time around. Adam Pope, thank you for joining up. Robbie as well. Robbie hosts, apparently, the Legacy of Power Rangers episodic podcast, which is the Patreon account that he signed up from. So thank you, Robbie. Are you familiar with did you watch Power Rangers back in the day?
I did, actually. I did that and Transformers. I was quite fond of them.
That's amazing. I was a huge Power Rangers fan. And then the last one, want to thank Remco, who signed up using a Patreon name that uses different size letter O's to make googly eyes, which is amazing. So, thank you everyone for joining up, and hopefully you're enjoying all of that extra bonus content that's been going out and that we have archived from the last couple of years. I got to ask you, how have you been in the last couple of weeks? Because main show-wise, it's been a little while. Like, you and I have done – we did a bonus episode, in fact, in between. We did an episode of TCBCast Now, but since we did the Wild in the Country episode, we've been talking privately, but how have things been?
Yeah, things have been really, really good. I did watch something Elvis related. I don't know if you want me to cover that.
Yeah, let's go ahead and talk about it, because Gradeep and I and Ryan probably will not watch this, but you did actually watch 2/3 of the Elvis's Women documentary.
I did. I mean, you, Ryan, and Gurdeep will be raising your eyebrows at me, but I was just really curious. But I got through two parts, and I just couldn't watch the third, because it was really boring, and it was clear to me what they're after, because you can hear the interviewer in the background asking about sex with Elvis. So clearly they just wanted to find out how much sex Elvis was having. And there was this awkward moment where, because Barbara Hearn was on it, and she was brilliant, in fact, and the interviewer says to her, you know, did you and Elvis have sexual relations, essentially? And she just says, I don't appreciate that question. And of the women who are on it, I have to say Barbara Hearn and Anita's daughter, those were the two classiest women on there. And I've got a feeling that they kind of signed up to it thinking it was something very different, because their accounts were very respectful and very balanced and just very different to some of the other accounts on this documentary. But I think the thing that wowed me the most was Suzanne Finstead. So she's the one who wrote the book on Elvis called Child Bride. And she is a tabloid.
Let's be clear. It's mostly a book about Priscilla.
Yeah, it is a book about Priscilla. And yeah, I mean, she's just basically there's far too much of her on the show. And you'd think that she was a kind of psychologist, like professional, because she's on there and positioned as an expert on what Elvis was feeling, you know, how he was kind of sexually. And, you know, she just basically would psychoanalyze him. And it was intensely annoying. And also factually, she clearly didn't understand the timeline of his music either. So basically, it was really boring. And I couldn't watch the third one.
Dang. Well, there you go, folks. You wanted us to talk about Elvis's women and get that out of the way. So there's your TCB cast review.
It's pretty scathing, isn't it?
Other documentary that came out, one I did watch. I did sign up for the little free trial that Paramount Plus gives for like a week. And Ryan and I both logged into the TCBCast account, and both of us watched Reinventing Elvis.
Fantastic.
So I know
fantastic.
You watched that already, and you were kind of holding off on giving too many spoilers when we last talked about Reinventing Elvis. But yeah, we can talk about it now. After.
Yeah, so what did you think?
I liked it. I think that for most fans, they're going to really, really enjoy it just because it's a nice documentary that puts Elvis at the center, makes him look good, and makes the Colonel look bad. I have a lot of quibbles with it, but that's my job.
absolutely.
So I guess let's start, because we had kind of talked a little bit about how it very much presents Elvis and Steve Binder as sort of the heroes of the story. Yeah. Colonel Parker is the villain. We talked a little bit about how Elena Nash is involved, and that there's a good chunk of the documentary that is about, essentially it pulls directly from her book, The Colonel, or Elvis and the Colonel, the sort of theory that Colonel Parker may have been involved in the murder of a woman back in Breda. I did a little digging on the company, the production company that was involved in the making of this Meteor 17. And I guess back a few years ago, they had announced that they were working on effectively this was in 2017. They were planning on producing a movie, like an actual biopic based on Elena Nash's book, The Colonel, that was going to be co-produced by Steve Binder and Elena Nash. And since that biopic didn't come to fruition, that's why she's so heavily involved in this documentary and why there's such a big chunk in the middle dedicated to a section of her book. But I think the best parts of the documentary, I think I'll start with the positive. Obviously, very polished, very well produced. I'm glad that they were able to clear up all of the rights, licensing and stuff with the estate to get the rights to the footage, because that elevates it substantially. But I think in terms of the actual documentary itself, because like you can just say like, well, the best part was watching Elvis, but that's just the special and the outtakes. Like that's a given. That's not part of the documentary. Yeah. I think the best part of the documentary was the stuff that we haven't heard before. The new perspectives from the cast and crew, some of the audience members that they had tracked down that were there.
That
was all really good. And then as someone who was just fascinated by the history around it, I really liked when Steve Binder got to talk about the stuff he did before working with Elvis.
Yeah.
So talking about the Tammy show and talking about the Petula Clark special, that was way more interesting to me than the 68 special stuff.
Really?
Yeah.
Really?
But I've watched so much and read so much about the 68 special that I'm the wrong audience for this documentary. Like this is definitely intended for the typical Elvis fan or the casual viewer.
And absolutely. Can we just talk about that scene when they reenact the Colonel potentially murdering this woman, and it's just like it's straight out of Dateline?
Yeah, it reminded me like of those old 90s like TV tabloid shows where they would do dramatic recreations and stuff.
And I think that's the thing about this documentary, and I'm not quite sure if I'm going to express it very well, but I'm going to try, is that it's almost following too many genres. So you've got you know, the kind of historical context. It's very much kind of like a historical documentary. And then you've got the talking heads and the individuals playing music. What's the name of that dude who you like who plays the music?
Well, yeah, there's Drake Milligan, who's in there. That's it, and then Drake Milligan. Also Darius Rucker, who's a country and pop musician. And then there's also Mafio, I think is his name.
Yes, yes, yeah. That was it. So you've kind of got them and them talking about Elvis and, you know, the kind of impact on Elvis, impact of Elvis from their perspective. And then you've got this whole thing about, you know, the hero, the what did they call the colonel?
The villain.
The villain. Yeah. Like the hero, the villain, and then Steve Binder is what Steve Binder.
Well, actually, Steve Binder was the hero. Elvis was the star, so Elvis doesn't even get the hero credit. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And then, you know, you kind of segue into this kind of murder reenactment. So I don't know if genre's probably not the right word, but do you see what I mean? They use these different, not techniques to.
Yeah.
Am I making sense?
No, I get what you mean. It's trying to hit a lot of bases all in one go. And it does feel a little disjointed at times. And certainly, like, there's a point where you're just like, okay, can we hurry up and get past all of the history contextualization stuff and get to the 68 special?
Yeah. Yeah. But, you know, I guess, like, for the average person watching this, they might not understand, you know, kind of the context of Elvis and kind of Elvis's explosion. So kind of we know that inside out, you know, so I kind of feel that I'm okay with that. But it did go on forever.
Yeah.
Didn't it?
No. And like I said, for a more casual viewer who might just be a little interested in like, oh, I saw that Elvis movie last year and kind of like that, this might be good, too. Adds perfect context. Like, that was fine. One of the other quibbles I had is that it frustrated me that it takes forever for the name Bones Howe to get brought up.
Like, that's so true.
I don't think either Billy Strange or Billy Goldenberg get mentioned at all.
No, they don't.
Like, it is clear, and, like, to be fair to Steve, he made the 68 special. Like, he's the director, but also history is written by those who live the longest. So it definitely, you know, he's the producer on it. He was the director of the project. He's allowed to take his victory lap on it. But I do wish that more flowers had been given to his other collaborators who worked on that special and made it possible.
Yeah, because, like, Steve was a director, but he wasn't the musical director.
Right.
This is all about music. So I absolutely agree. And I said to you on last time we spoke that the documentary I wanted to see was one made 30 years ago when, you know, they're all alive and we could hear them talk about it. That would have been fascinating.
Yeah. So, but otherwise, like, generally, I'd say give it a watch. If you've got Paramount Plus, if you're in the States, I'm not sure where it's at on the other in other regions in terms of streaming. But it's worth a watch, I'd say, absolutely. The other bit of news that came out is that we, in between the last time we recorded and this, we got confirmation that the official release date for Priscilla is confirmed for October 27th, 2023, so just in time for Halloween, if you want to scare yourself a little bit.
Don't judge it too early, Justin.
I'm not judging.
It might be incredible.
No, I'm sure, like I said, I think it's going to be a very well-made film. We did get a new interview from Sofia Coppola and Priscilla about the film in the Hollywood Reporter. It's a good article. I enjoyed reading through it. It had some interesting tidbits kind of confirming, like, yes, they're not allowed to use any Elvis recordings. They confirmed that the budget was only around $20 million. There were some descriptions in there. It's interesting how the article even kind of tiptoes around the minefield that is, like, the Elvis and Priscilla relationship. Because at the end of the day, Priscilla has been extremely consistent in recent years about wanting to make sure that Elvis is represented well in the way her story is told. And so even the Hollywood Reporter article, you know, just kind of says, like, the movie includes scenes that can be read either as reflective of a bygone, more patriarchal era or alarming at any time. So it kind of gives you the option of, like, the way I read this sentence is almost like whatever you want to get out of this movie, you're probably going to get out of it. So if you want to take it as, going into the film expecting to hate Elvis, you're probably going to come out hating Elvis. And if you go in expecting it to be like, well, that's just how it was back then, you'll probably come out feeling the same way.
Yeah, good point.
So, but yeah, so we have confirmation on the release date for that. The other thing that happened during Elvis Week was that there was a special event held celebrating Lisa Marie's life. And from what I understand from the report in the newspaper from Memphis, the commercial appeal, apparently they did play, Joel Weinschenker played an unreleased duet version of You'll Never Walk Alone, which she had apparently recorded vocals for the Where No One Stands Alone album.
Mm-hmm.
But obviously the version that is on that album doesn't have her vocals on it. Instead, it's just on Where No One Stands Alone. So the people who were there got to hear that exclusively. And I don't think that's going to be released. I think it was just a treat for that event. From what I understand, there was like a photo montage or something that was played while that was being played. So, but that's very nice. I'm glad that people were able to gather to remember Lisa and get to hear this very special treat that she had recorded on a project that she clearly, felt very strongly about at the time. So,
yeah, absolutely.
The last bit of news before we get into our main topic was the Aloha from Hawaii set dropped.
Yes.
And Ryan got his copy, and he had mixed feelings about it privately. I don't want to speak too much for him other than to say that he was quite disappointed in the quality of the Blu-ray, the visual quality of the footage on the Blu-ray. And he sent us some examples, short clips and stills of how it appeared on his screen, and it didn't look great.
No, it didn't, did it?
It's a shame. I think there may have been some attempts to try to brush it up a little bit, glow it up a little bit, sharpen it, maybe bump the saturation a little bit, and they may have just pushed it a little too far. But I understand why the Aloha set came out especially for new fans. It's nice to have a package. Like I'm getting to the point now where I was a little bit like Gurdip, I think, earlier this year, where I was just like, these darn kids needing their Elvis re-releases all the time. But if you're a new fan who came off the Elvis movie and you never got a chance to pick up the Aloha from Hawaii sets of Days Gone By, it's nice to get that. Whether you listen to that on Spotify, whether you pick up the physical edition, like there's always a new generation of fans. So I'm glad that it's available.
And wouldn't we rather that they put material out than not put material out?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So that's it for Elvis news this week. Just two short emails from listeners. First one comes from Paul Shakespeare, who's written in a handful of times. And he says, hi, Justin, because he was just emailing me, I guess, but in reference to the Wild in the Country episode. It says, another amazing podcast. When hearing about the movies Elvis almost made, my mind ran to a story that I had read in Sammy Davis Jr.'s autobiography. In addition to being party pals, so this is a quote from the book here, quote, in addition to being party pals in 1957, Sammy and Elvis planned a professional collaboration that year. In his autobiography, Sammy claims he and Elvis were being considered for the lead roles in producer Stanley Kramer's upcoming film, The Defiant Ones. The script dealt with two chain gang prisoners, one white, one black, who escape while chained together. Forced to work together, the two men develop a deep respect for each other by the end of the movie. It was a real heavyweight drama, Sammy recalled. Our chemistry on the screen and in the press could be sensational. Of course, when Colonel Parker heard about the idea, he killed it. Davis said Elvis had tears in his eyes when he explained his manager's reason for doing so. He says that all those people out there who buy my albums, among them are lots who won't want to see me chained to a colored guy and end up liking him. Sammy called the project's failure one of the great disappointments of his life. Elvis's performance in 1958's King Creole affirmed Sammy's belief that Elvis could have handled the dramatic role in The Defiant Ones. Instead, the role went to Tony Curtis opposite Sidney Poitier. He had a great talent as a screen personality, Davis asserted, and a couple of things he did, like King Creole, showed genuine promise. End quote. This has always intrigued me, as apart from Sammy's book, I've never heard this mentioned, and it would have been amazing to see Paul. Yeah, I had not read that story before, but that doesn't surprise me, given that I know that Elvis and Sammy hung out quite a bit in the 50s and in also the 60s and 70s. Like, we know Sammy even appears in That's the Way It Is in the end credits.
Yeah, he does. But do you think Elvis would have said that about how his fans wouldn't appreciate him being chained to a black man and then ending up liking him?
Yeah, I think Colonel Parker very easily would have made that case to Elvis, and Elvis would have been bullied into going along with it, you know. And I think Sammy would have been given it a little more straight than Elvis might have couched it with some other acts that he, you know, might have wanted to collaborate with. Mm-hmm. I think Elvis really, really respected Sammy. So, like I said, I'd never heard that story before, but I'm glad that you sent that over, Paul. I really appreciate that. And Paul included a little note as well that he is starting a spinoff podcast from Ghosty Wills's We Say Yeah, doing a pre-Fab Four British rock and pop 1954 to 1962 show. Since he says there's very little talking about this period in depth, I'm planning on an episode on the search for Britain's Elvis, so would love for you guys to be a guest if we have time. Yeah, absolutely, we'd be down for that. So I'd love to talk about Billy Fury and Cliff Richard and all of that. There was a whole string of British Elvises. So. Mm. Second email comes from Manasi, who writes in to say, "Hi, Justin, Beck, and Ryan. Enjoyed your review of the film. What struck me when I watched it was how different Elvis's character's relationship with decently written female characters was in the beginning of his career. Be it Lisbeth Scott or Hope Lang or Carolyn Jones, they played characters with strong personalities and backstories. While they do suffer from period-appropriate sexist tropes, their relationships with Elvis's characters have a broad range and not just as orbiting him. They are well-written and filmed well and are central to narrative and portrayed sympathetically as trying to manage living in a patriarchal world. They have agency in the climactic resolution. In fact, it is them who save him in a way. Their interplay allows him to show some truly memorable acting chops. I wish a smart filmmaker would have explored Elvis's status as a sex symbol in a narratively apt and created a solid niche for Elvis. He was certainly capable. I also find it fascinating that Scott and Lang are portrayed as quote-unquote older, professional women who have sort of a boss-mentor role, who also have a romantic relationship of sorts with Elvis, who was a teen-slash-youth sex idol, which is quite bold for his auteur. It makes for a different and interesting dynamic, very different from later periods of mostly interchangeable female characters who are poster girls for some of the worst sexist tropes ever. Girls, 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 anybody? I had this bizarre thought of Hope Lang as a stand-in for Sam Phillips and Lisbeth Scott for Colonel Parker, haha. But seriously, Elvis did have very strong female supporters in the beginning, like Marion Kiesker, Mae Axton, and Anne Fulcino. I don't know if you've read Sue Wise's essay From Butch God to Teddy Bear about alternate female gaze vis-a-vis Elvis. Highly recommend, if not, maybe an episode on best to worst written female characters in an Elvis movie would be a good idea for TCBCast. Cheers.
Yeah, she's got a really good point, actually. I hadn't considered that.
Yeah, absolutely. And definitely Lisbeth Scott stands out as one of, like, I think one of the best written female characters in any Elvis movie, for sure. Glenda. Absolutely. And what I love about that character is that, like, that had to be created out of whole cloth, because that character, as Jamie and Joan and I talked about when we did the review of that film, in the original short story that it's based on, that character is a guy. So there's no romance there at all.
No, there wouldn't be with that.
So, yeah, not in the 50s.
No.
So, but yeah, that's great emails, everyone. So let's go ahead and move on to our main topic. We sort of devised an interesting kind of off-the-wall main topic to talk about. Previously in the past, Pradeep and I have done a few episodes where we've ranked certain Elvis songs of a certain theme. One of my favorites was when we did, like, the movie Driving Songs. Sometimes we've talked, right? Sometimes we've talked about just ones that fit a particular theme. Like, I remember one year we did, like, it wasn't even a ranking, but we just found, like, all the songs that were on Valentine's Day, but they were all of Elvis's songs that were not about love or romance in any way. Surprisingly, not that many.
Really?
Yeah. Wow. Shockingly few. If you leave out a lot of the goofy movie songs, like, obviously, yeah. Queenie Wahine's Papaya or whatever is not going to count. But yeah, so you and I were kind of talking about what topic to do, and we kind of brainstormed this idea about doing an episode on Elvis's most lonesome or lonely songs, but to actually help us zero in, because that could go any way we wanted if we wanted to just dig into any song that was about loneliness. We actually decided to go for the ones that literally have lonesome, lonely, or alone in the title.
And I had no cause to die. Sing it, baby. Shall I come back again? Tell me, dear, are you lonesome?
I love this one.
Yeah. And what I've noticed over the last however long it's been that I've been an Elvis fan is that loneliness is one of the strongest concepts associated with Elvis Presley.
Mm. And yeah, even if it's not mentioned in the title, right?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, even one of the most famous current biographies that are out there about Elvis Presley right now by Ray Connolly, you've got Being Elvis, A Lonely Life, you know? And I was just thinking about that and thinking about why do we associate Elvis so much with loneliness as a theme and as a concept and as an idea. But yeah, what do you think, Beck?
I think, well, I mean, just randomly this thought comes to my mind. I think it was Paul McCartney or maybe one of the other Beatles said that, you know, we were really lucky. We had each other, but Elvis only had Elvis, right? He only had himself. And so his path must have felt really lonely, regardless of how many people he had around him. And I think, you know, in some books there's mention of him, correct me if I'm wrong, actually talking about loneliness and how he was lonely. Am I making that up?
No, I pulled actually quite a few quotes from Elvis about loneliness that I was able to dig up.
But I do like just closing the thought. I do, you know, you can't help but wonder whether a lot of his musical choices were chosen because, you know, the themes of loneliness really, you know, he really related to that.
I suppose this kind of talk raises another question. Am I in love? No. I thought I'd been in love, but I guess I wasn't. It just passed over. I guess I haven't met the girl yet, but I will, and I hope I won't be too long because I get lonesome sometimes. I get lonesome right in the middle of a crowd. I've got a feeling that with her, whoever she may be, I won't be lonesome no matter where I am.
Yeah, well, there are reports of him getting in his truck even in the 60s and driving off around Memphis just to be on his own.
Yeah, yeah. And also in the 70s, you know, he would take his motorcycle out and things like that. And solitude isn't always necessarily a totally bad thing. That's worth mentioning as well, is that there is a peace and comfort in solitude, you know, and just having some time away from noise and chaos and just giving yourself the quiet that you need. So I think certainly Elvis had that as well, you know, that's why part of the other reason why, you know, he spent so much time, you know, people talk about his bedrooms and things like that, and there were very much these private places where he could just get away from everything, you know, and just be in a space that was, you know, truly his own, you know. And I think it's important that everyone has that, you know, not just, you know, Elvis Presley, but everyone.
But what I look at myself as, not being, you know, I'm not really playing everything down, but it, as a human being, really, has been very, extremely fortunate in so many ways. Although I have had and still have some very lonely and, you know, there are times when I really don't know. It feels like I don't know what I'm going to do next, you know. But I've experienced a lot of the different phases in life. I've experienced happiness and loneliness and the wealthy side of life, the average side of life, you know, not having anything, but not knowing what it's like to have anything, so. And tragedy.
But yeah, so I just, I had those. I have one quote that I will talk about later, but let's go ahead and dig into these songs. And I think the way we're going to do this, you and I privately ranked these songs amongst ourselves, like without telling the other where we would generally kind of rank these. But not to make this definitive individually, but we're going to talk about these in chronological order and try to convince the other person where we need to scientifically rank these as the best Elvis songs that are about loneliness, that feature lonesome or lonely or alone in the title. So
now, remember, this is personal taste again. And
this is not personal taste. This is scientific. It's a process.
Oh, okay. So we're doing scientific. Okay. We found 11, didn't we? 11 songs.
Yes, we found 11 songs with these words in the title. I was looking. There might be one from the Million Dollar Quartet that we didn't snag. I'm with the crowd, but so alone. I don't know if we want to count that one, but yeah.
I think we deliberately left that one out, didn't
we? Yeah, we're pretty much sticking to studio recordings and home recordings. Let's go ahead and do chronologically, and then we can talk about where we put it on each of our lists.
Okay, all right. You go run through them chronologically.
So first one up is Lonesome Cowboy in 1957.
In my dreams the lights shine bright and pretty, near to me and yet so far. Will I always be a lonesome cowboy? Am I only reaching for a star?
For a star, for a star, for a star!
Where did you put Lonesome Cowboy? And what do you think of it?
I ranked this one at number 7.
Mm.
Yes, and... I put it at number 7, which is sort of like it's not at the bottom, but you know, it's kind of edging towards the bottom. But you know how you say that in, you know, in songs like I Believe and I can't remember what the other ones are, but he just sounds quite overblown and like he's overdoing it.
Yeah.
I just feel that about this song, you know, the opening of the song and then when he goes ride, 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 cowboy, like it's all a bit much. So that's why I stuck it close to the bottom of my list. I mean, you know, it is quite atmospheric and I'll give it that. But that's where I put it. Where did you put it?
That's certainly fair, because I put it at number 6. So it's pretty squarely in the middle. Like, I love the arrangement. Like, it is very much hearkening back to, like, sort of singing cowboy-type songs. So I've got an affinity for that kind of built in. And I've just always liked it, just aesthetically, just that it has this very haunting, sort of clippity-clop, you know, aesthetic, and in a way kind of has a vibe similar to Blue Moon, which is, speaking of lonely songs, like, that's a very lonely song.
Blue Moon, you saw me standing alone, without a dream in my heart.
It is. But do you know what? I challenge you on that. I would not put Lonesome Cowboy, you know, next to Blue Moon at all.
Oh, no. Blue Moon is so high up, would be so much higher on a list of lonesome for me.
No, but in terms of hauntingness, if that's a word, that is way more haunting.
It is. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah.
But, you know, even the arrangement kind of gives this feeling like, oh, he's out alone on the trail, you know, and things like that. You know, so, you know, we're developing this list. It's the first one we're talking about. So I'm comfortable starting this off and agreeing with you. Let's go ahead and put it at 7. And this could potentially get pushed up or down depending on what happens with the rest of these.
Okay. All right.
Let's do that. So, okay. All right. First, next up from 1959, a home recording from the Army. Now, this was a relatively recently discovered one. Oh, Lonesome Me, a cover of the Don Gibson song. What do you think of this one, given that this is one that you probably haven't spent that much time with?
No, I haven't. And actually, when it was on the list, I had to re-listen to it because I can't even tell you when I last listened to this.
Yeah.
So obviously, like, the Don version would have been the one that he listened to. And I stuck it at number 9, so quite close to number 11. The only thing I potentially – no, it's not the only thing, but I think what I like about this song is I think Elvis is playing the guitar on this. Do you reckon he is?
Yeah.
Yeah. And I really like that. I think I've said before on the show, like, I love it when Elvis accompanies himself either on the piano or the guitar. And that's pretty much the only thing I can say about this one. So it's at number 9.
Mine is at actually a little lower. It's number 10. But I think it's mostly just that I don't have the sentimental attachment to having heard it as much as these other songs over the course of, like, my fandom.
Yeah.
Because, like, I really like the Don Gibson original, and it was thrilling to find, like, God, a new Elvis recording that we've never heard before.
Yeah.
And for it to be a song that I really like from that artist. And like you said, having Elvis accompanying himself, it sounds very loose, very fun. But it being a home recording, it is a little less polished. So yeah, this one went a little lower for me. This was at number 10. So
I think what it is if you listen to all his home recordings, this is just not that interesting, I don't think. And if it was, we'd know it a lot better.
Right, right. Yeah, and it hasn't even, like, gotten that much play. But, yeah, not very many people have heard this. But so let's go ahead and we'll definitely put this one underneath Lonesome Cowboy. Where you said you had this at number 9?
Yeah, let's put it at number 10.
Yeah, we'll put this at 10. I'm comfortable with that for now.
Yeah.
Okay, next one chronologically. Are You Lonesome Tonight? 1960.
Are you lonesome tonight? Do you miss me tonight? Are you sorry we drifted apart?
Well, I think people are going to throw things throw things at me for saying this. But I have it at number 4, which is, you know, like, it's not low, but it's, you know, it's still number 4. And, like, I acknowledge this is a classic and the studio version is so haunting. But if I'm going to listen to Are You Lonesome, I won't lie to you, I generally pay the, you know, the Hampton Roads 72 version.
Yeah.
Yeah, which is, it's basically on tour, isn't it?
Right.
Is your heart filled with pain? Shall I come back? Tell me, dear, are you lonesome tonight?
I'm going to talk to you, man. I wonder if you're lonesome tonight. You know, someone said the world's a stage and each must play a part.
Yeah, that's the one I will listen to. But what I will say about this song, like, the genius bit of this song is actually the spoken section, because he makes it sound so easy and so fluid. But actually, when you sort of dig deep on it, you know, with the wrong emphasis and tone on certain words, it could have sounded so phony and not that convincing. So he really nails it on this. But yeah, I mean, I stuck it at number four. Oh, the other one I like, actually, the version is, you know, the Sit Down Show in 68? Like that because his voice has just matured so much.
And that's one of the few live versions that he actually does it pretty straight. Like, he doesn't goof off too much on it.
Do the chairs in your parlor seem empty and bare? Do you gaze at your doorstep and picture me there? Is your heart filled with pain? Shall I come back again? Tell me, dear, are you lonesome too?
Yeah, yeah, because at the Vegas ones, he just...
Oh, yeah, goes completely off the rails.
But that's my case for number four. Where did you put it?
I also put it at number four. I think it's very strong, but there are a couple. There are a couple more that I like more than this. But I, what I always liked about "Are You Lonesome Tonight," aside from just like the vibe, like the of the studio version, like it's just you put headphones on and this encompasses you like a warm blanket. Like it's just so good.
Yeah, it does. It's very intimate as well, isn't it?
Yeah. But what I've also always liked about this is that as a song about being lonely, I like that it's a message that's like from a person who's at a distance, wondering if the person that he's separated from is feeling the same way that he's feeling that, you know, that night, you know, and it's not even really a direct question to the person. At least that's how I've never read it. It's almost more of a just pondering out loud to themselves, you know,
which
makes it feel more lonely.
I read it that they're still together.
That could be. That could certainly be.
Yeah, and just that they're... he talks about, I'll bring the curtain down. So if you don't feel the same way about me, are you lonesome tonight because we're not together?
Yeah.
That's always how I read into it.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. I think you're probably clearer there. But yeah, we definitely put it at the same spot. So I think we're safe
for now. Yeah.
For now, okay. At number four.
And we seem to be agreeing with each other again. We need to stop this.
Jumping ahead to the next year, 1961, one from a movie that we just talked about, Wild in the Country's Lonely Man, cut from the film, of course, but in the trailer. Lonely Man, now we can go either way on this in terms of whether we want to talk about the studio, like full band arrangement or the solo version. Yeah. I'm going to be honest, personally, I like the solo version better because it's more lonely.
Absolutely. That's what I said, the acoustic version.
It's a lonely man who travels alone, when he has no one that he can call his own. Always so unhappy, taking shelter where he can.
It's a bit like In My Way, isn't it?
Yeah.
In that respect. Yeah, I'm agree. Like, I'm not a big fan of the accordion I ended up slapping on top of it. So I stuck it at number five.
At number five.
Oh, my God, Justin.
We were agreeing too much. We did not consult on this beforehand.
No, we did not.
See, this is clearly scientific if we're coming to the same conclusions from a distance. But yeah,
I prepared to battle you, Justin.
Yeah, no, but I do like this recording. I don't like it even in that film as much as obviously In My Way. And honestly, it's pretty neck and neck with Forget Me Never. So
yeah, no, that's true. It's the same ilk, isn't it?
Yeah, very much. So yeah, I think we can pretty comfortably set this at kind of squarely in the middle of our list at number five. So, we'll see what happens from here on out. 1963, It's a Long, Lonely Highway.
It's a long, lonely highway when you're traveling all alone. And it's a mean old world when you've got no one to call your own. And you
I'm going to make the case for this because I think it's another winner from Palmerston Schumann. It's got boots on it.
Yeah.
Anything with boots on it is fantastic. And I will argue that this is a bit of a hidden gem. And I actually wish they'd made it an A-side instead of a B-side. And I love the kind of upbeat nature of it. And it puts a smile on my face every time I listen to it. It's a bit like Follow That Dream.
Yeah,
or the totally. Follow That Dream's a superior song, but it's kind of, again, it's of that same ilk. And I also like the way it's used in the opening scene of Tickle Me. Like, obviously, they didn't record any original music for that movie because they had a $10 budget. But, you know, this actually fits really, really well in the movie. I'd forgotten about how much I liked this song until I listened to it again. So I put it on number three.
I went higher. I went number two.
Oh, did you?
I did. I really liked this. The best thing about this is, like, when you listen to the lyrics, like, it's clear that this guy is having a horrible time. Like, he's drinking from, like, muddy puddles and stuff like that. But, like, he makes it sound fun. Like, I want to be miserable with this guy.
I got a rock for my pillow. Drinking water's muddy, so don't you tell me, buddy, that I wouldn't be better off dead. It's a lonely highway getting longer all the time.
Like, it's a long, lonely highway, but man, we're going to have a heck of a time going down this long, lonely highway together, which is, you know, counterintuitive to the point of the song, but...
Okay. Oh, so you put it at number two.
Oh, yeah. I love this recording.
Oh, you see, I don't know if it warrants a number two spot. Like, I would put it at number three, but I mean, two or three. I don't know.
So we're both in agreement generally above Are You Lonesome Tonight?
Yes, we are.
Okay, so we'll set it there above Are You Lonesome Tonight on the list.
Okay.
For now, just to be agreeable, we'll put it at number three, but I may fight you if one of the later songs I feel deserves to be at number three.
Okay.
A lot harder. Okay. So
let's do that.
Okay.
Yeah. All right.
We'll set it above Are You Lonesome Tonight. Okay. From the first of the 1966 recordings, because there's three of them here to talk about. The home recording, It's No Fun Being Lonely. Now, this is one that I don't think we've really even talked about that much on TCBCast.
We haven't.
It's a home recording that was apparently written by Red West, and really, Red's taking the lead on the vocal, and Elvis... Mm. Very prominent on the recording. Like, I think he's closest to whatever microphone, you know, the tape recorder that's out there. But they're with Charlie Hodge as well, and they are throwing themselves into this.
Oh, just how long can I exist in this world?
No, they are, but it's still at number 11 for me because it's not one of Red West's finest creations.
Wow.
I
put this at number 9.
Did you?
I put this above even Are You Oh Lonesome Me. So.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know. I don't know if I agree with that.
See,
it's a pretty ordinary song. I think it would be more interesting if Elvis was singing lead and maybe I'd feel differently about it. But because he's not singing lead, it just doesn't do anything for me. Like, I don't really care about hearing Red West sing lead on this.
Yeah, I see where you're coming from. You make your case really well. I just like the song itself a little bit more than I like Oh Lonesome Me. So let's see. So you put this all the way at the bottom.
Yeah, but I'm okay with it going up, provided it doesn't go up too much.
So we've got right now Oh Lonesome Me at number 10. Would you put this above or below Oh Lonesome Me?
Below, for sure.
Below.
Mm.
Yeah, I can agree with that.
You don't agree with me all the time. Like,
yeah, but like
you can
Elvis
absolutely say
isn't the lead vocalist on this. Like Oh Lonesome Me, he absolutely is. So let's bump Oh Lonesome Me up to number 9 and let's put let's put It's No Fun Being Lonely at number 10. This is pretty low.
Okay. All right. Yep. Happy with that.
Okay. The second of the 1966 recordings, let's talk about Leave My Woman Alone, another one where Elvis is not very audible on.
He's not. And I've got a couple of questions about that. I mean, first, can I just say I really love the Ray Charles version. I don't know about you. But so this is what I don't understand. So they basically recorded the backing track to this. And, you know, Elvis didn't go home. He was singing baritone or bass on this. And you can actually hear him.
He stayed there.
Yeah, he stayed there. But here's the question. If he stayed there, then why didn't he lay down a vocal on this? Because that would have been brilliant if he had.
I have no idea. He's not needed for the bass vocal. You have the Jordanaires there.
Yeah. Well, we know how much you love playing, you know, singing bass. And maybe that's it. But, you know, if he's going to sing the backing track, then, you know, get on the mic and sing the lead.
Yeah. Why waste people's time?
No, I know. And also, I think... wasn't there, like, you know that track you've got to stop?
Yes.
From what I read, like, you what movie is that from?
You gotta stop, because that's the one with the freeze frame. That's is that Easy Come Easy Go? Which is the same movie that this was intended for. Yeah,
exactly. And so the story is, and I don't know if this is accurate, is that it was basically a choice between the two. And then Elvis decided to record You've Got to Stop, which I think is the superior song.
Not at all. Leave My Woman Alone would have absolutely been the better song.
Yeah. So this is one of the confusing things for me, and such a shame, really, that he didn't record it.
Yeah, definitely. Where did you put this on your list?
So I put it on number 8 on the grounds that he's not really singing it. He's just singing the bass.
That's pretty high, given that he's not, like, really there. I sank this down to number 11.
Oh, did you?
See, my problem with it is, even though I like the song, I like Ray Charles' version of it, I think that this would have been a pretty bad version of the song. Like, this instrumental, I don't think would have been very good. I don't think Elvis on Easy Come, Easy Go would have dug into the lyrics the way that the song would have deserved.
Okay.
So, right. Granted, Jamie and John could potentially do an AI version that blows my mind. And it's just like, yeah, that's what that should have been. Same instrumental and everything like that.
Get in trouble if you don't want to, don't have to. Get in trouble if you don't want to, don't have to. Get in trouble, well, you better leave my woman alone. Woman alone.
I have, by the way, that's not a teaser. I have no idea what their next AI project is.
So you did actually put that below It's No Fun Being Lonely.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
You know, and like, be fair, like, even on the backing vocals that Elvis is present for, he does sound weirdly kind of engaged with it. Like, he's even starting to sing before the backing vocalists, the Jordanaires or whatever, join in. So it's clear that he's enjoying doing the recording of the song. I don't know. Yeah. For me, I put this quite a bit lower. So you had this at number 8. I have this way down at number 11.
Well, look, I'm happy to put it down. Do you know why? On the basis that he's not singing lead on this. I think what it is I'm influenced by the fact that I would have liked to have heard his version of this.
Right.
And maybe that's influencing me a little bit. But you know how he wasn't singing lead on It's No Fun Being Lonely. And on that basis, we moved it down.
Yeah.
I'm happy to do that with Leave My Woman Alone.
Okay, so would you say this below It's No Fun Being Lonely or above No Fun Being Lonely?
Well, personally, I would put it below.
Okay, that's where, yeah, I'm down to put it down below. We'll bottom this one out, number 11.
All right, let's do that then.
Okay.
We'll put it number 11.
This is a scientific process, very scientific. last one from 1966, we saved the best for last from this year, Where No One Stands Alone.
But I don't know a thing in this whole wide world that's worse than being alone. Hold my hand all the way, every hour, every day.
Yes. Now, I am going to surprise you here because you probably thought I'd put You'll Never Walk Alone at number one. But I actually put this at number one because, yeah,
really?
I didn't want to be predictable. Yeah, I did, because there's something about the way this song builds, because it just really grabs you, like the backing vocals, the passion. I've just loved this, how it just starts really like level and you kind of think, oh, this is just going to be one of those songs that kind of just stays at the same level the whole way through, but then it just builds and builds, and as I said, it's just, you know, it grabs you by the balls. I don't know if, can I say that as a woman, even though I don't have balls?
Yeah, because you're perfectly capable of grabbing someone else, you know, or describing someone else being grabbed by, like, no one stopped from... let's stop this line of questioning.
Well, okay, I'm just going to say, I just feel it just really grabs you by the balls. And we do have a live version of this, and I think it was the only time he sung it, in February 1977.
Yeah.
And he didn't rehearse it. He must have just decided on the stage, I really feel like, singing Where No One Stands Alone. Because he's at the piano, and the only accompaniment is the stamps. And it doesn't match up to the studio version, but it's still a wonderful listen. But I won't lie to you. Like, I think I put this at number one because I just didn't want to put You'll Never Walk Alone at number one because I thought you would.
We'll get there with You'll Never Walk Alone. But honestly, I put this at number three because while I do appreciate the song and, like, lyrically, I love the song, his impassioned vocals are enough to take it this high up the list for me, even above Are You Lonesome Tonight. But I personally prefer the live 1977 recording. In fact, when we listed off our favorite Elvis recordings by year, that was my 77 recording over Unchained Melody. Like,
I adore
that version of it. And that the affection for that recording of this is more what pushes this high up for me. Because I think that the arrangement here is pretty dated in hindsight. Like, I understand, like, of, like, obviously it's the 60s, like, what do I expect? But I do think that if it had been given a less bombastic arrangement, more like You'll Never Walk Alone, well, I guess You'll Never Walk Alone is also bombastic, but it's not, Where No One Stands Alone is a little more poppy, I guess. You know, there's a little bit more in the way of instrumentation on there. It's not just Elvis banging away at the piano. I like the rawness of that on the live version so much better.
Yeah, okay. So. But that's what makes the song, is the bombasticness, I think.
Yeah, but it's not really there on the studio version.
I disagree with you.
It builds to a climax, but I don't think it gets quite as far, which is why, So we've got Long Lonely Highway at number three. Where would we put Where No One Stands Alone? Because you've got it at number one. I've got it at number three. I clearly put this below Long Lonely Highway on my list, but that's mostly just because I really, really like Long Lonely Highway. But that's like, scientifically, I don't know that I could, that would pass the test, you know, since we're going by real science here, you know.
Yeah, I know, absolutely real science. Oh, but you know what, Justin, I think I agree with you. I mean, I actually, Like, I know it's weird because I put it at number one, but I don't know if I'd put it above Long Lonely Highway if we were kind of re-ranking them, because we need to sort of agree on the ranking.
Mm.
I don't know. I'm just not decided on this one. Would you put it below Long Lonely?
I did on my list, and I probably would. Like, I think, okay. And certainly, I think Elvis is in very fine, like, vocal shape on both songs. But I don't know. Long Lonely Highway hits, but like, he sells me on Long Lonely Highway, and Where No One Stands Alone. Like, again, it doesn't quite hit me the same way that some of his other gospel material does. It really is the live version, and even honestly, the Lisa Marie duet version I like better than the original studio version, because they even restructured the lyrics to, you know, make it a little bit more contemporary in terms of structure. So that's where it sits for me.
Okay, well, you've really bashed my choice here. Look, I will move it down, and I'm okay with it. I'm okay with doing it.
Okay, so are we putting it?
I think what it is you know how we talk about the fact that, you know, when you do these ones, it's kind of a moment in time. And I've been listening to a little bit of gospel at the moment. I think it's because I recently listened to How Great Thou Art, and also his earlier gospel album. So maybe that's it. Maybe that's sort of colored. I'm a bit of gospel mood at the moment.
Hey, nothing wrong with that. So we're comfortable slotting this in at number three underneath Long Lonely Highway?
Oh, so Long Lonely Highway is number two now. Okay, yeah, I'm okay with that. I can live with that.
In between. Yeah. So this is above Are You Lonesome Tonight?
Yeah.
Cool. All right. Next one up from 1967, Just Call Me Lonesome.
I climb the stairs up to my room, but no one greets me in my gloom. The silence tells me she is gone. Just call me lonesome from now.
I put it at number 10 because this is one of my least favorite songs.
That's right.
You know, the fact that it was recorded on the same day as Guitar Man and Big Boss Man, like, you can't really believe that, really. I literally have one line in my notes which says, doesn't do anything for me. I just don't like the instrumentation, and I'm gonna say something Gurdeep would say here, even though I do like country music, is it's too stereotypically country for me.
Okay, that's fair. It's fair.
So I put it at number 10. Where did you put it?
I slotted it at number 7.
Oh, okay. So, and you clearly like it a little bit.
I do like it. My quibble with the song is that Elvis at times sounds like he's straining for some of the higher notes. You know, and I think that they settled on a key that maybe wasn't the right one for this song. Like, it's still, like, I still really enjoy this. I was introduced to this song, like, the first place I heard Just Call Me Lonesome was the Guitar Man version, you know, the overdubbed version from the 80s. So
I know how much you love that album, Justin.
These walls will hide me when I cry. Let hope, let heaven lets me die.
I have a greater fondness for that version of it, but I appreciate what Elvis and the Nashville A team and the band were going for in 67 with this. But this definitely goes a little further down the list for me, partly just because I think Elvis is straining a bit. But I definitely wouldn't put this as low as number 10.
Would you put it at 8 or 9?
I think I could pretty comfortably, well, yeah, I could drop it down. Would you put this above or below Oh Lonesome Me?
Above.
Above? Well, hey.
Oh, wait, hold on. Let me just think about that. Well, again, you know, I'd put it below. I would put it below.
Below?
Do you think I'm being mean about it?
Maybe a little.
Yeah?
I'm also biased right now because I literally just did a 3-hour episode on Elvis country music in the 60s.
But also Guitar Man was your favorite album, wasn't it? And you listened to those versions before you heard the originals, right?
Yeah. But I think Elvis is certainly vocally stronger on this than on O Lonesome Me.
I would put it above O Lonesome Me on the grounds that, yeah, he sings. He's obviously singing it better.
If we don't show our work, people won't believe that we followed the science, you know.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, the good news is,
I acknowledge that he sings it well.
The good news is that we actually had an open spot at number 8. If we want to slot it in there, just below Lonesome Cowboy, just above O Lonesome Me. How's that sound?
Okay, let's do it. Yeah, let's do it.
Okay, we're cool with that. All right, next one, 1967 as well. You'll Never Walk Alone.
My favorite song is a song called Padre. Are you familiar with it by Tony Arden? And also, You'll Never Walk Alone was always one of my very favorites.
Walk on through the way.
Need we say more?
Yeah. Well, I don't think so. We've just banged on endlessly about this song, but it's just exceptional. And for those who haven't listened to previous episode, it's actually the song that both Justin and I have picked for our funeral song, which is really morbid, but, you know, what a great song to go out on. And, you know, Elvis banging on the piano, it's just got such charm. And if you strip out the backing vocals, you can almost shut your eyes and you can pretend he's singing this at home. So I put this at number 2, but I really wanted to put it at number 1. I was just trying to be unpredictable. It hasn't worked. Where did you put it?
Oh, you know, number 1.
Number 1.
Yeah. It's going in the number 1 slot. This is clearly better than Long Lonely Highway and Where No One Stands Alone. This is going at number 1. And what I love...
Do you know what?
Oh, go ahead.
Oh, sorry. I was just going to say, I'm a complete idiot. Like, I should have just put it at number 1 because I like it. I love it more than When No One Stands Alone. What was I thinking? Gosh, must have had too many margaritas. Sorry, I interrupted you. What were you saying?
No, I was just going to say, while we're on the theme of loneliness and being alone, what I love about this is that it's a reminder that we're not alone, you know? And that, like, there is comfort you can find, that there are people you can reach out to or presences that you can reach out to if you're inclined spiritually, you know? Mm. And so, yeah, I love that we can put it number 1 of the lonely, alone, lonesome songs, the one that is the most reassuring that you're not.
Yeah, no, exactly. And I am completely aligned with the number 1 spot. You have my full support on that.
Unless you want to put I'm So Lonesome I Could Cry higher.
Here that lonesome whippoorwill, he sounds too blue to fly. A midnight train is winding low. I'm so lonesome I could cry.
No way.
So that's the last one that we've got. I'm So Lonesome I Could Cry from 1973, written by Hank Williams Sr. On the Aloha from Hawaii special where Elvis performed this. So anyone who picked up that Aloha set or listened to it on digital streaming services will have heard this very recently, been reacquainted with it. I certainly gave it another listen when that release came out, and I like it. I like it quite a bit. Where did you put this on your list? I'm curious.
I put it in number 6 because I'm one of those people that thinks it sounds really flat on the Aloha Show. Like, it almost feels like he just didn't put as much effort into this version. And I think if the version that I prefer and love so much more is the home recording one, you know, the 73 version, because it's beautiful and his voice is perfection. And I'm pretty sure he's accompanying himself on the guitar.
He is. And yes.
Yeah. I mean, this is, if we were talking about this version, it would be so much higher, but I put this at number 6.
Did you ever see a robin weep when leaves go drifting by? It means he's lost the will to live. I'm so lonesome I could cry.
Interesting. Okay. Yeah, that's higher than I put it. I put it at number 8, below Lonesome Cowboy and Just Call Me Lonesome. Mostly because I was rating it on the Aloha from Hawaii Master. Because I generally am kind of in agreement that, like, this is one of those songs in the pacing of his live shows. Like, obviously, he puts songs in order in the set list to give him a chance to, like, recuperate his energy a little bit, you know, in between the high energy, you know, kind of high octane rocker numbers, or the ones that, like, were like American Trilogy, like very show stopping big pieces, or Welcome to My World or something like, or What Now My Love rather. So he's got these songs like I'm So Lonesome I Could Cry that are relatively easy by comparison to sing. And he does sound a little out of breath on this one.
Yeah. So this is like a recovery song.
Yeah. But like, Elvis, even in the broadcast version of the show, describes it as maybe the saddest song he ever heard. And Hank Sr., like, paints this very evocative picture with his lyrics that still holds up. Like, the way he describes, like, it's essentially like nature itself is mournful, you know? And
so sad.
I absolutely love this song. I just, you know, struggle with the specific performance that I was rating it on. But you mentioned that home recording, and absolutely, I think that one stands very well. Looking at what we have on the board right now, where would I slot this? I would definitely put this above Just Call Me the Lonesome, which we've got at number 8 right now. Do you think this would go above Lonesome Cowboy?
I've actually got it above Lonesome Cowboy because my original list, Lonesome Cowboy is number 7.
Would you put this above Lonely Man? I think I probably would.
No. Yeah, I would. I think maybe my thinking is very much colored by that home recording of this song.
Yeah, but also I do really like the song. Like, I think I'm So Lonesome I Could Cry is absolutely a better written song than Lonely Man.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. Let's put it above Lonely Man.
Okay, would you... So, moving that one down to number 6, would we say, compared to Are You Lonesome Tonight, higher or lower?
Oh, gosh, no. Lower than Are You Lonesome.
Okay. So this would slot in at number 5.
Are you okay with that?
I'm cool with that. Yeah. Like, yeah? As we've talked through it, this has gone up 3 spots in the ranking from my list. So you talked me into it.
There you
go. So, and it went up a spot on yours. So we ended up agreeing even better. See, this is why it's the scientific process. We work through all these things. So
do you want to go from 1 to 11 now? Did we end up?
So, yeah, we'll count it down. Number 11 was Leave My Woman Alone. Number 10, It's No Fun Being Lonely. 9, Oh Lonesome Me. 8, Just Call Me Lonesome. Number 7, Lonesome Cowboy. Number 6, Lonely Man. Number 5, I'm So Lonesome I Could Cry. Number 4, Are You Lonesome Tonight? Number 3, Where No One Stands Alone. Number 2, Long Lonely Highway. And number 1... You'll Never Walk Alone.
Yeah. I actually, like, I sense that Where No One Stands Alone, you'd actually want to bump that down a little bit, wouldn't you?
No, I'm cool with that.
You're cool with that?
Yeah, I'm cool with it being above Are You Lonesome Tonight. Like, it's not what I think other people would maybe rate it, but I'm cool with it.
So our last 3 on the list are the home recording ones, aren't they?
They are. And the unfinished studio recording with Leave My Woman Alone. So basically the ones that aren't like real Elvis recordings for exactly. commercial release. I'm cool with this list. And again, like, I'm joking this whole time about it being a scientific process. It is totally subjective. It's really more an excuse for us just to talk about some Elvis songs that we really love. Everyone else might have a completely different order that they would put this in. That's the fun of doing a project like this and just goofing off about this. I hope that no one takes it as seriously as I'm joking about it. This was a ton of fun to get to talk about. And, of course, I do want to give an honorable mention to a handful of other songs that talk about loneliness in their lyrics. Of course, we mentioned Blue Moon. You Saw Me Standing Alone. There's Unchained Melody.
I've hungered for your touch. A long, lonely time.
I'm left, you're right, she's gone. I'm left all alone.
You're right, I'm left, she's gone. You're right, I'm left all alone.
Reach out to Jesus as you bear it all alone.
Is your burden heavy as you bear it all alone?
Little Cabin Home on the Hill. Tonight I'm alone without you, my dear.
Tonight I'm alone without you, my dear. It seems there's a alone for you still.
Tomorrow is a long time, then lonesome would mean nothing to me at all.
If tomorrow wasn't such a long time, then lonesome would mean nothing to me.
The biggest honorable mention at all, the song that Elvis had his first number one hit with, Heartbreak Hotel.
That is true.
Well, since my baby left me, well, I found a new place to dwell. Well, it's down at the end of Lonely Street, that Heartbreak Hotel, where I'll be just a lonely baby. Well, I'm so lonely, I'll be just so lonely, I could die.
So many great songs that Elvis recorded about loneliness and being alone, and that all of us fans have found comfort in over the years. The last little quote that I wanted to talk about, and I'm sure that you've read about this too and heard about this, is a handwritten note from 1976 that was found in Elvis's Hilton suite. Are you familiar with the Elvis letter?
I am.
I'm gonna go ahead and read this and see if I can make it through. Quote, I feel so alone sometimes. The night is quiet for me. I would love to be able to sleep. I'm glad everyone is gone now. I will probably not rest tonight. I have no need for all of this. Help me, Lord, to get through all of this. I'm so tired of it. I think I would like to sleep forever, but rest does not come easy for me. Show me a way out of these problems. I want, and then it trails off.
Walk on, walk on, with a hope in your heart, and you'll never walk alone. You'll never walk alone.
So, let's go ahead and move on over to Song of the Week, shall we?
Wonderful. Let's do it.
Here he is, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Elvis Presley.
Well, get out of that kitchen and rattle those pots and pans.
What a night. Ooh, what a night it was. It really was such a night.
Well, when Monday comes, she's Tuesday. When Tuesday comes, she's Wednesday.
I'm wearing the heart of Rome.
He talked and talked, and I heard him say,
I know that you've been told, it's not fair to tease
the edge of reality.
right, Beck, do you want to take it away first?
I will do. My song of the week today is Almost in Love.
Your lips were made for kisses so tender. I'm almost in love tonight. When we are close, my heart says surrender.
And I've always loved this song, and it sits in a category of songs in my head called the Elvis Cocktail Lounge Collection, because yeah. It just sounds like you'd be listening to it in a cocktail lounge. And there are some other tracks that sound like that, and I just couldn't remember them for this. But I first heard it on a compilation before I even saw the Live a Little, Love a Little movie, and I've just always loved it. And in its first iteration, it was actually a song called Moonlight in Rio and written by a guy called Luiz Bonfá. And he was a Brazilian classical guitar player and composer. And he released Moonlight in Rio in 1966. And if you listen to it, it's really a bossa nova instrumental track. Like, it could almost be the backing instrumental track to Almost in Love when you listen to it. Like, it opens with the flute, it has the guitar and then the string. So there's... I don't want to say they're the same fundamentally, but they're very, very similar.
No, they're pretty much the song, identical.
Yeah, they are.
you're being extremely generous.
Okay, and
we're not, you know, this is nothing, like, the songwriter, the original, is fantastic. Luiz Bonfá's, like, original. It's just that when they adapted it for the movie, it's just a one-to-one copy of that, like, with just added lyrics, so.
Yeah, it's fair enough. Yeah, I agree with you. But the song was then adapted by Randy Starr, and he's the one who co-wrote a number of songs for Elvis's movies. Like, he did Adam and Evil, Could I Fall in Love, Dayton, Kissing Cousins. And he's also responsible for adapting Old MacDonald, so shame on you, Randy. So fair to say they aren't amazing songs, are they? But it was recorded on March 7th, 1968 at the Live a Little Sessions at the Western Recorders Hollywood. Now, this is the same session that produced Edge of Reality, which is one of our collective favourites, isn't it, Justin?
Mm-hmm.
So Billy Strange was actually arranging and producing this session, and he apparently quite liked to record with a live orchestra. So there are strings, there's wind, there's brass accompanying Elvis here. But I kind of questioned whether this would be accurate, though, because I remember reading that when he recorded the 68 Comeback Special and he went into the studio, it was actually the first time he'd ever recorded with a full orchestra. So I don't know if that would be accurate, that they were actually kind of strings, wind and brass actually in the studio, or whether they were actually overlaid later. I don't really know. But the song is quite deceptive, because it's actually, when you listen to it, it's actually a really, really hard song to sing. And Elvis, as usual, probably just makes it sound really easy, because I'm sure it covers two octaves in this song. So I think it's actually quite hard to... I think it's actually quite hard to sing. But I haven't asked you what you think of this, Justin.
Oh, it's from Live a Little, Love a Little. I love this. Like,
yeah.
I adore that movie. I love the soundtrack. Like, I was obsessed with A Little Less Conversation. Edge of Reality is one of my all-time favorites. I know it's one of Ryan's all-time favorites as well. I even like Wonderful World a lot. I know that was one of Gurdip's, like, very first songs of the week. It wasn't his very first, That Was Such a Night, but one of his very early ones. And despite even that song not being written for that movie, it fits in very well.
It does.
And, like, honestly, this might be one of Randy Starr's best songs that he wrote for Elvis. Granted, he didn't write the melody, which helps. He's working from a good baseline of a song that already exists, a melody that already exists. But as an adaptation of that melody, I think he does a very good job and gives something for Elvis to work with.
your lips were made for kisses so tender. I'm almost in love tonight. When we are close, my heart says surrender. I'm almost in love tonight.
No, he does. And he had to make up for old McDonald, really, didn't he?
Yeah. The arrangement that Billy Strange came up with, is it just me, or do you get sort of like a kind of off-brand Burt Bacharach vibe off of this?
Oh, yes, that's so true. It is very Burt Bacharach-y.
Yeah.
So in terms of takes, take one has a longer acoustic intro, but it breaks down before Elvis's vocals come in. We don't have take two, three. Take four breaks down in the intro, and take five, Elvis is off key, so he stops singing. Take six is complete, but you just get a sense that he's still testing out the song, so it very much feels like a rehearsal, and he's actually struggling a bit with it, and at the end of the take he actually says goddamn, so he's kind of finding it hard.
I'm almost in love tonight. Almost in love.
God.
But untangling the takes for Almost in Love, it's actually quite tricky because the FTD hasn't actually made it easy. I don't know what you think, Justin. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was so tricky that you and I had to have a conversation about it to try and break it down.
And we still got confused a
but
little.
I'm going to avoid getting into the weeds. And all I'll say is they tried the song in a lower key and Elvis gives it a good go. But, you know, he still struggles and he's laughing and he says, oh, shit. And they tried in a higher key. So that's probably as much as I'm going to say, because it is actually quite confusing.
And here, under the spell of evening, I long to hold you tight.
So take four ended up being the master, and in the movie he sings it when he's doing a bit of an awkward slow dance with Michelle Carey, but it's actually quite cute, and it was released as a B-side to A Little Less Conversation on September 3rd, 1968.
I have that single.
And that is my song of the week.
Nice. I love it.
It may just the spell of evening. I'll oh shit.
Well, over to you, Justin. What did you pick this week?
Yeah, I popped into the 1970s, 1970 specifically, for Release Me from the Onstage album.
Oh yeah, you're gonna like it. Play it hard now.
Oh, please release me. Let me go. For I just don't love you anymore.
You know, I don't know how much I've talked about this, but one of the earliest live Elvis concert CDs I had, like, obviously I had the cassette tape of Madison Square Garden, so I loved that. But I also did have On Stage 70, and I've been listening to that a lot more recently, and I was reminded, like, I really love every song on this. Like, it's so good.
it's good.
And I realized that this hadn't been covered, and so I had to dig into it, because as it turns out, this is a country song, like, very country. This dates back to 1949, when it was recorded by Eddie Miller and his Oklahomans.
Please. go.
Interestingly enough, was released in January 1950. Eddie is one of the co-writers on the song, along with Dub Williams and Robert Yount. But his version didn't really go anywhere until it was picked up. The song was itself was picked up 4 years later by two other country artists, Ray Price and Kitty Wells. And they had effectively competing versions of it. Ray's dropped in January 1954 and Kitty Wells dropped in February 1954. Ray's eventually ended up hitting number six on the country charts. And his version pretty closely follows the model of Eddie Miller's original. Like, it's very stereotypically country. Honestly, you joked recently about, like, are there any country songs you don't like? Certain types of country songs I don't like, or certain styles of country singing, certain artists won't resonate with me. Like, a country song that I will listen to for the sake of historical information, but I'm not going to seek Eddie Miller's out. Kitty Wells, on the other hand, did a little less well than Ray Price's, but peaked at number eight on the country charts. Arrangement-wise, aligns pretty closely with Eddie Miller's arrangement as well, but she's got this wonderful voice, this honky-tonk sort of singing gal that just, I love her voice, I love a lot of her music.
I have found a new love, dear, and I'll always want him near.
And then through the 1950s and 60s, it was recovered by just a kajillion artists, mostly in the country field. Lefty Frizzell, the Everly Brothers, Floyd Kramer did an instrumental version, Jerry Lee Lewis, Ernest Tubb, Statler Brothers, Eddie Arnold, Chet Atkins, Bobby Bear. Just the list goes on and on and on. On the pop side, Dean Martin did a version that is actually pretty good. Didn't chart or anything, but just on one of his albums, worth checking out.
Oh, I have found a new love, dear, and I'll always want her near. Her lips, they're warm.
Darren also did a version. Just a ton of excellent, excellent versions. But one that I want to talk about that was a crossover pop hit was Esther Phillips did a version in 1962 that went number one on the R&B chart and number eight on the pop chart. Now, I'm curious, Beck, if you have ever heard any of Esther Phillips' music before?
No, I haven't. Should I?
Yeah, Garrett and I actually on this upcoming country music series talk a little bit about Esther Phillips, just in passing, but she was one of those early 60s soul artists that was also a country artist, and she had an entire run of country singles and a country album that are just really awesome to hear, but because she was black, didn't get the chart on the country chart.
I said I found a new love, dear,
but just a fantastic country soul version that she recorded, very much in the vein of the Nashville sound, just with much more soulful, like almost gospel influenced vocals that are really fantastic. So highly recommend people check out Esther Phillips' version. Jumping ahead a few years to the late 60s, 1967, Engelbert Humperdinck did a version of it. Maybe the closest you could point to as sort of a predecessor to where Elvis takes his version, but not really, because it's much more easy listening, whereas Elvis's, as you'll hear, hard blues, like blues
sure.
rock. Elvis is much more supercharged, but I will give credit where credit is due. Like, Engelbert Humperdinck, good singer, good version of it, just a nice, pleasant, easy listening version.
I have found a new love, dear, and I will always want her.
But yeah, 1970, Elvis's version on the On Stage album. So interestingly enough, there are two versions from the night of February 18th, 1970. The earliest one is The Dinner Show, which was released on the On Stage FTD because they were recording material for that album. And The Dinner Show is where The Master of the Wonder of You was recorded, but the version of Release Me was not selected. It was the one at the Midnight Show that was selected as The Master. Interestingly, on that Dinner Show version, you can hear Elvis introduce the song. He jokingly calls Glenn Hardin Jerry Lee, because Glenn Hardin comes in with this very honky-tonk sort of piano intro that's really fantastic.
You got it? Play it, Jerry Lee.
But yeah, that evening at the Midnight Show, that's where we get the version that appears on the album On Stage. What do you think of Elvis's version of Release Me, Beck?
I really like it. Like, Engelbert Humperdinck's version just sort of sends me to sleep, and Elvis just brings so much more to it. But I heard it for the first time on Platinum, A Life in Music.
Yeah.
They have a rehearsal on it.
Mm-hmm.
Have you heard that?
Yes.
Of course you've heard it. That was a really stupid question. You've heard everything. But that's where I was introduced to it. And, yeah, I mean, I just love his live versions for that very reason. He's like, he gives the song a kick up the ass, basically.
Yeah. No, it's fantastic. Mm. And, like, what I love about, like, he's got these interjections where he's like, you know, he's like, let's play it hard now, you know, right at the beginning. And has essentially transformed the song. Because you listen to all these other earlier versions, and they're let's be like clear, like they're a lot slower. Like this is not a like up-tempo country song, like the way that most artists have been treating it throughout the 1960s. Elvis like cranks it up to 11 and like sort of gently coaxes out the light blues elements that are already there in the song, in the way that it was written, in the way that country music is always infused with a little bit of blues in there. But he just like fires it up with the band, and it's so wonderful. And there is a recording from the following night, February 19th, that gets even harder and even faster. And Elvis would continue to perform this through February 1970, and he would continue to perform this through the rest of his career. There are versions from early 1971 that can be heard on various FTDs and bootlegs. One notable one is the April 14th, 1972 version from Greensboro, North Carolina, which was recorded for Elvis on Tour, which people would have heard very recently on the Elvis on Tour box set.
Oh, really sweet, my darling, let me go.
Chug-a-lug,
baby. Oh, please release me. Let me go. For I just don't love you anymore.
Again, 1973, he's performing at Vegas, Lake Tahoe. If you go listen to those, he's vocally a little weaker by comparison. 73 was a little rough year. 75, he would occasionally drop it into set lists. It didn't pop up as much, but he would reintroduce it into his set list again in 1977. And it's clear that he just really enjoyed performing this. And in fact, it's on his very last concert, June 26th, 1977, Indianapolis, Indiana. And honestly, listening to the recording, he sounds pretty good on it. Like, the one thing that I'll note about the 1977 versions is they are surprisingly quite a bit slower, because in the 70s, as we know, he would sometimes rush the songs, even songs that he typically did take a little slower in the early 70s, you know, some of the ballads and things like that. By the time you get to 76, 77, even the band is starting to pick it up a little bit. But yeah, they've kind of measured themselves on this final version from the final concert. Yeah, I've always liked this recording. I don't know why I've never picked it as Song of the Week. But it's clear that Elvis absolutely loved performing it and loved the song to death. So I wanted to feature it as my Song of the Week.
I think it's a great choice, Justin.
Yeah, so there we go. That is our episode for the week. Any final thoughts, Beck, before we wrap it up?
No final thoughts from me. That was really fun.
Yeah, that was a ton of fun. Let us know what you think, folks. If you want to just chime in on the list and your favorite songs that Elvis did about being lonesome or loneliness. And yes, I am aware there are a couple from the Million Dollar Quartet that we did not include on this list. As I mentioned earlier, like, we're just kind of, this is for fun. Don't take it so seriously.
True.
So yeah, shoot us an email, tcbcast@gmail.com. We're on various social media accounts. And of course, if you want to support the show, you can do that over at patreon.com/tcbcast. We'd really appreciate the support. Helps us to continue to do the show, try to keep the quality high. And you know, I know that you've told me multiple times to like not thank you anymore because you're just part of the regular crew now. But seriously, thank you, Beck. You have put in so much time over the last couple years, and especially this month when Gurdeep has been out of commission because he's got weddings and stuff that he's doing, birthdays to celebrate with his family. He's taking time this month for his family, and I know folks want to hear him again. I know we've missed him. He's missed being on the show, but it has been so great to have you, jump into the seat as often as you have. So,
well, thanks, Justin. It's been really fun. And it's been great to get on some episodes with Ryan as well.
Yeah, absolutely. So, I think that's it for the week. So thank you, everyone. I believe it's a hot time in Florida.
It's a rainy night in Georgia.
You've been listening to the TCB Cast, an unofficial Elvis fan podcast.
Someone must have stomped on his head with those blue suede shoes.
Thank you, and good night.